Since the beginning of VISTA, which March is 2 years, we have decided to make missions a priority for us as a church. And so we, from the very beginning, looked and prayed about who we could support in missions early on, even though we are a brand new, what we would call a baby church. We still want to have that as our DNA. And we're praying that as we grow as a church, God would provide and show us more opportunities for us to be invested, not only in the ministry here where we're at, which would be our Jerusalem, but also in Judea, Samaria, and for the most part, as the Bible says, the uttermost parts of the earth. So we prayed about that, and it was a real easy one for us because Kathy Paschal, who heads up our children's ministry here, her daughter and son-in-law are missionaries in China. And so we talked and we said, you bet, let's right away start supporting them on a monthly basis. And so VISTA Church has been supporting Bryce and Kelly Musgrave from the beginning, $200 a month. We raised it our second year to $250. And Lord willing, we're going to continue on a yearly basis to continue to raise that and invest in the ministry that they're doing. And so I want to be able today invite you to give a warm welcome to Bryce and Kelly Musgrave as they share about the ministry that they're doing in China. Give them a warm VISTA welcome.
Good morning, everybody. We're privileged to be here with you today and be able to share with you, talk a little bit about what God's doing in the part of China we're in, look at the scriptures, see what it has to say about missions. We've prepared a video that we want to show you. It'll give you some more pictures, put faces on people, see places where we're living, what's going on, and give you some more information. So right after the video, I'll come back up and we'll look at the scriptures together. So thank you.
All your children will stay. reach out your hands. Children, in Christ you stand.
Shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. Thank you. goodness faileth never. Good shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever.
Well, like I said, we are happy to be here with you today and feel blessed to be a part of this community and this fellowship. You got a lot of the information about what we're doing and where we're living in there, but if you have any questions, just come up to us afterwards, ask questions. We're serving some authentic Snow Mountain Creamery ice cream in the back, so all of you are welcome to come and get a scoop or two of ice cream and ask questions. When we go back, we're excited because we've been living in Xining, China, in the western part of China for 7 years. And that's the capital city of our province. And we've been planning and working towards getting up to an area about 12 hours away, which was Yushu, which is a 12-hour drive. And it sits at about 12,000-foot elevation on the Tibetan Plateau. And so it's hard to get permission to move up there. And for all those reasons, it's why we've opened this ice cream business. And it looks like it's the right timing as we go back this spring to try to make the move up to the Yushu area. So in order to do that, we still need to raise $10,000 to cover housing, transportation, the move, all the expenses that go with that. And then we also still are looking for about $800 a month in monthly supporters to partner with us in the work for all the living expenses and everything that goes along with living in China. So we don't twist arms or pressure people, but we just trust that God will put it on hearts of the certain people that he wants to partner with us in different levels and trust that to him. But we are privileged to be here today, and we're going to get into the Word and study a little bit and look at why missions and what God has to say about missions. But first, let's just pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a good Father, that you're merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. Lord, you're good and you are beautiful, and we are satisfied by you. And we want the nations to be satisfied by you. We want them to know the peace and the joy that comes with knowing you, Jesus. Jesus, your yoke is easy and your burden is light. And we thank you that there's nothing we can do to make ourselves right with you, but you have freely given us grace and poured out your love on us. And so, Holy Spirit, be working in our hearts this morning as we look at your word. Open our eyes to see wonderful things in your word and just to understand and comprehend what you want us to know. And so we thank you that you're here with us, and we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So for this message today, I just titled it simply, Why Missions? And so I'm excited to be here as Vista is a young-ish church plant coming up on 2 years, but it's still a new local community here, and we are excited to be a part of that. Like Brandon said, from day one, they have supported us and decided to support us in the work over there. And so we're happy to be sent out from this local expression of the body of Christ here. And so I just want to ask you guys, individually, personally, and together as a community, why missions? Why is that important for you? What does God have for you to do? Vista Church, why missions? What does God have planned for you to do? And just want you all to be thinking about that as we go through this. And I want us to open up to Matthew chapter 28. Verses 18 and 20. Most of you are probably pretty familiar with this passage. It's the very end of the book of Matthew. It's called the Great Commission. Starting at verse 18, it says, "And Jesus came and said to them, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age.'" And so this is a familiar passage of the Bible. This is the Great Commission. It's the last charge that Jesus gave his disciples before he ascended back into heaven. It's his parting words as he went back into heaven was, "Go and make disciples of all nations." And so why is this important for us today? Some people might be thinking, Well, maybe he was just talking to the 11 disciples at that time. Maybe they were to go out and make disciples of all nations. In verse 16, it says it was the 11 disciples that Jesus was talking to. But if you actually look at that passage, there's a couple clues that will show us that he's talking to much more than those 11 disciples. He's talking to all Christians through all ages. And he's in the command itself. He says, go and make disciples of all nations. And so that is including all nations. And that idea of nations is not just geographic political nations. It's people groups, different language groupings, smaller groupings than that. And so we know that there's still, the gospel has not reached all nations yet. So the job is not finished. And then at the end of that passage, there's a promise. And Jesus says, behold, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And so we know that because it is to reach all nations and that Jesus promises to be with us to the end of the age, we know that this command is also relevant for us today and for all Christians of all times until Jesus comes back. So let's look at this and think about it. I have 3 points, 3 kind of answers or reasons to the question, why missions? And these are 3 motivations that I hope will help move your hearts closer to that idea of reaching the nations with the gospel. So number one is because he said so. This is the most simple and obvious point that I have. But it's true. We were bought with a price, with the blood of Jesus. We are no longer our own, but we serve another. And his yoke is easy, his burden is light, but he is our Lord. And he is the last thing he told us to do before he went back into heaven was to go and make disciples of all nations. And so we should take seriously what he's asked us to do and what our part in that might be. So that's the simple answer, because he said so. But it doesn't hold the power of motivation to accomplish this great task in itself just because he said so. Christianity is not a religion of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps and getting it done by your own strength and power. So, point two holds more of this power of motivation, this idea that is actually going to carry us through doing something large and difficult. And it's because he's beautiful. So point two on why missions is because he's beautiful. And this is a key motivation in all of the Christian life, in all of life, because he's beautiful and glorious. The Westminster Confession, the first point in it says, the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. And I think it's a really good summary of the center and ultimate purpose of what it means to be a Christian, of what it means to be human, is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. And so Christianity is not a religion like other world religions or other belief systems in the world. Other world religions and belief systems will say, you need to do something to get right with God. There's a problem and you got to fix it. Or you need to manipulate something so that you can experience the spiritual realm. Or you need to do something so that you can come to God. But Christianity is different from all other world religions because it's a religion that where God came and did something for us. So it's a religion of grace. There's nothing that we can do to make ourselves right with God, but God, in his wisdom and love, sent Jesus into the world to become incarnate and live among us. You know, speaking of going to other nations and living in other places, Jesus stepped out of heaven and was born as a baby in Bethlehem and became a man. And so Christianity is fundamentally different because it's not about what you have to do to get right with God but it's about what Jesus did to bring a broken, sinful people back to himself. That's us. We're broken. We're sinners. We're all in different phases in life, have different struggles, different pain. But Jesus is about redeeming people like that and bringing us to God. So, the second point, because he's beautiful, this motivation, this is central in the Christian life, is seeing Jesus as beautiful. For everybody, all of us here, for me, preparing this message to share with you, my greatest need was to see Jesus as beautiful. And then I'll have something to share with you and to impart to you because I've seen glory, I've seen beauty. You know, Moses went up on the mountain, and he spent time in the presence of God on the mountain, and when he came back, his face shone and glowed because he spent time in God's presence, and he had something to impart the people of Israel. And that's how it works in life. Our greatest need as people, as believers, is to see Jesus Christ as beautiful and all-satisfying. If you're in here today and you're just visiting, maybe you don't follow Jesus, maybe you're just visiting for some reason today, or are in somewhere in process, you're kind of considering, maybe someone shared with you the gospel, and you're kind of thinking through, like, is this true? Is that ring true? Is that something I want to follow? Your greatest need is to see Jesus as glorious and beautiful, and that he is all-satisfying. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 and 4. I'm going to kind of jump through a bunch of scriptures as we go, so you can try to open up and read those, or they should be on the screen also if you want to follow along. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 says, "And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled only to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." And so if you're on the outside looking in on Christianity and just considering, your greatest need is to see that Jesus is glorious and beautiful and all-satisfying. Now, Christians, you've been Christians for a different amount of time, different places in your walk with Jesus. In the process of sanctification and growth in holiness, your greatest need is to see Jesus, is to see Jesus more clearly and be more satisfied by Jesus. Also in 2 Corinthians, in chapter 3, verse 18, we read, "And we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another." So this process of being changed into the image of Jesus also comes from beholding glory. And that's where the change, the heart change, comes from. None of us has it in our power to change our heart motives or desires just by our own willpower. But the power to actually change your heart, your desires, your motivations, is by seeing beauty and seeing glory. It's just important to all of us in the Christian life that we see beauty. Now, the appropriate response to beholding something beautiful is to praise it. And we all do this all the time in different ways. We see something that we enjoy, something that we think is beautiful, something we really just delight in, whether that's sports, an athlete, a lover, a family member, an artist, a band, a car brand, whatever. If you really appreciate something and enjoy it, you're going to praise it and you're going to want to tell other people about it. It is natural to human nature. It's how God's made us. Now, one of the most important books in my life on missions outside of the Bible has been John Piper's Let the Nations Be Glad. And it would be worth the whole price of the book just for the first chapter. There's so much in there. But I'll just read an excerpt off the first page. He says, "Missions is not the ultimate goal of the church. Worship is. Missions exists because worship doesn't. Worship is ultimate, not missions, because God is ultimate, not man. When this age is over and the countless millions of the redeemed fall on their faces before the throne of God, missions will be no more. It is a temporary necessity, but worship abides forever. Worship, therefore, is the fuel and goal of missions." Now, that sentence, that one little sentence, that worship is the fuel and goal of missions, has just stuck with me through our whole process of God leading us to go to Tibet as missionaries. And it's been a long process of trying to sense God's call and leading and what he wants us to do next. But that idea that worship is our motivation and our fuel to actually accomplish the task has stuck with us through the whole time. So beholding the beauty of God and then worshiping, This is our motivation for doing missions. Christians, if you have beheld some glory and you have appreciated and loved that Jesus has first loved you and died to save you from sin, then the appropriate response would be worship and praise, going and telling other people. In the Gospels, we see stories of Jesus healing making the blind see, causing the lame to walk, healing the ears of the deaf and letting them hear. And often their initial response is just to praise Jesus because all of a sudden they haven't seen anything their whole life. And then this man has caused them to be able to see beauty and light and color and or walk or hear. And their response is praise. But often after that, it's also to go into the villages and towns and tell people what Jesus did for them. And so that's an appropriate response for us when we have seen the beauty of Jesus and in the gospel and scriptures, just to praise God and then go tell other people about that good news. Gospel means good news. And go tell other people. And so I just hope as Vista Church and individual members and people in this local body of Christ, that the passion will be to see Jesus and worship him together, and then to go out into the communities around you and share it with your neighbors, with your families, with the people you work with, and just be a light where you're at. So I want to look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8, another Great Commission kind of text. It might have been the same event or right around the same time. Jesus says to his disciples, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And so this verse has a outwardly expanding dynamic to it. It's right here in Jerusalem and then out in Judea and out to Samaria and then even all the way to the ends of the earth. And so as Christians, as a local body of Christ here, Vista Church's heart and kind of bent or leaning should be an outward expanding dynamic to this area, out to other towns, Arvada and Denver, and all over the surrounding areas, and all the way to the ends of the earth. I know from talking with Brandon last week that that's his heart from the beginning, is just that Vista be a light in this community and the communities around here and all the way to the ends of the earth. And so I'm super encouraged by that and just happy to be a part of this local expression of the body of Christ, except we're in Tibet. So this brings me to our third motivation for why missions, and that's because we cannot fail. Now, this is an awesome point, and it's been solid rock under our feet because it's not an easy job that Jesus has given us to do, to go and make disciples of all nations. There's all kinds of things that can hinder us in doing that, but we can't fail. Now, if we look at Matthew, we looked at Matthew 28, the command is go and make disciples of all nations, but sandwiching that command in the beginning is a reason and the end is a promise. And so the reason at the beginning is all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples. So that's the reason we go. And then at the end of that sandwich is this promise, and it's, behold, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And so we know that whatever he's asked us to do, he's not going to leave us. He will be with us to the end. And so we can have confidence that we're not going to fail at this job he's given us to do. I'm going to read a passage out of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 to 12. It says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so the life of Jesus also may be manifest in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. So our own weakness in completing the Great Commission, and trust me, I feel like often we're in over our heads, and we feel our weakness trying to run a business in a different country, learn languages, raise a family, get up to a place that we're not readily given permission to go. I feel like we're in over our heads, but none of us can use the excuse that I'm not strong enough, I'm too weak, because in fact, that is a qualification for being qualified, is that you know that you are weak and that Jesus is strong and that he shines his glory more clearly through weak vessels. So the whole point of Christianity, like we said earlier, unlike other world religions, the whole point is that the grace of God be glorified and magnified through Jesus Christ in our lives. And that happens best when we are weak and humble and trust him and follow him, and then he is able to do that. So as we look at this point, this third point of because we will not fail, we cannot fail, I want to look at Revelation chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. There's a picture that's given to us of the scene of heavenly worship. And so I want to read this passage. The four living creatures and the 24 elders are singing a new song to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain, and this is what they're singing to him. Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. And so we know from this passage, this glimpse, like as through a window into heaven, that there will be people from every tribe and language and nation worshiping Jesus Christ in heaven. And so as we go out into the nations to make disciples of all nations and obey this command, we know we can't fail, because as long as we are trusting Jesus and following him, he will see to it that in the end there's people from every nation worshiping him in heaven, and we have boldness because we can't fail. Now, just in closing, I want to encourage all of you, and meaning that also as Vista Church, the local expression of Christ here, and just encourage you to think about putting a special emphasis on reaching the least reached. There's a lot of nations and people groups that have churches in them already. There's Christians that are a light. They're reaching their neighbors. They're spreading in their country, in their community, in their people group. But there's still also a lot of people groups who have no Christian witness in them. They have never heard that there's a Savior who came to die for them and save them. And so I want to encourage you to put a special emphasis on reaching the least reached in your missions endeavors. If we look at Romans 15, chapter 15, verse 20, Paul is talking to the Roman church. He's sharing his heart with them. And this verse has been instrumental in our lives as well in following God to the nations. Paul says, "And thus I make it my ambition to preach the gospel, not where Christ has already been named, lest I build on someone else's foundation. But as it is written, those who have never been told of him will see, and those who have never heard will understand." Paul's heart, his ambition, he says, is to reach those who have never heard the gospel. And so he gives the excuse in the next verse to the Roman church of why he has not come to visit them yet, because he's been off doing this. But maybe on his way to Spain, he can stop and see them. His heart is to keep spreading out where the gospel hasn't been preached. And so Kelly and myself feel that burden as well, and that heart as well, and want to reach those who have never heard. Some of you may have heard of the 1040 window. This is just an idea that mission strategists have made up to communicate an area of the world that has the densest unreached population. It's a area from 10 and 40 degrees north of the equator, largely North Africa, the Middle East, and parts of Asia and Europe. And it has the highest concentration of unreached people groups there. A lot of these places that are still unreached are hard to reach places. So whether that's a Muslim nation where by going and sharing the gospel, you might actually be putting yourself in a physical threat in harm's way. And then other places might be just a place that's hard to get to and remote, and so people have never heard. But it's also going to be hard to get out there and share with them and live there. And so our burden is for the Tibetan people, and we're trying to go to Yushu, this place at 12,000 feet, and it's hard to reach. It feels like people are slow to receive the gospel. It's hard to get permission from the government to go out there. They're just big mountains. The highest pass we drive over on the way is about 17,000 feet. And so these are hard places to get to and live, but these are the places where darkness reigns, where people need hope, and they have never heard of Jesus. And so we're determined by his grace, not our own strength, but to go to these places. And so I want to encourage you as a community and as individuals to be thinking about what part God might have in this great commission for you. And so we've struggled a lot in starting a business. That's been one of the hardest things that we've had to do. We haven't had previous business experience besides just working a lot of different jobs. But starting a small business in another country was very challenging. And there was times where in the first 6 months, I was there 14 hours a day, every day making ice cream day and night. Just it was crazy busy. And so sometimes my heart is really to teach and to teach the scriptures, to learn language so that I can communicate with the people around me better. But so I find myself just struggling, thinking, what in the world am I doing? I'm just making ice cream every day. What is this about? But it's been neat to look back because it's also just a season of starting up, and so things will change and shift. But it's been neat to look back and see how building relationships with employees and suppliers and people in the community by being there every day in an actual role in the community that they can understand and see has been a big blessing. And we've had opportunities to share. I was just going to tell a couple stories about this young guy, Jordan, who works for us. He's a Tibetan guy. He's about 25. But he's a riot, and he'll come in, and he'll just walk around the kitchen singing Tibetan songs and just at the top of his lungs. And sometimes I got to pull in the reins a little bit as I'm like, there's customers. And like, he's in the kitchen. It's hot one day. So he just took off his shirt, and he's making ice cream cones. He's like, it's hot. I'm like, you got to put on your shirt. I'm trying to translate to him in Chinese how to say no shirt, no shoes, no service in Chinese. And he's like, oh, but they won't see me back here. And so I took a cup of water, and I dumped it on him. And he's like, ah, okay, I get the point. But we have a lot of fun with him. He's a good guy. But he's not a believer. He's kind of rejected Buddhism, which is strange for a Tibetan, because most Tibetans consider that it's intertwined with their identity as a Tibetan person. But he has an uncle in the monastery, and he just feels like he's seen a lot of corruption and is not happy with the system there, doesn't think it's true. And so he's been reading a little bit in the Quran and in the Bible and kind of seeking what's true. And so I've had great opportunities to talk with him, and he's a little bit argumentative and defensive, but he's also open and seeking. So it's really fun to talk with him. And he'll come in and he'll be like, I have three questions for you. Why are there women in the genealogy of Jesus? And we're like, well, let's talk about it and sit down. And this is kind of a rabbit trail, but we're talking about reaching the nations. And from the beginning in the Old Testament, when God formed the Jewish people, why are there women in the Old Testament? In the genealogy. And there's two, besides Mary, there's two, and neither of them are Jewish. One is a Moabite widow, and one of them was a prostitute from Jericho. And they're in Jesus' genealogy. So we see the heart of God even planning these things, first of all, for the nations and for sinners. And they were in David's line and in Jesus' line. And so we've had great talks about things like that. And he came in one day, and he said, I have to tell you something. I was walking to work today, and I was thinking about two things. I was thinking, one, like, how am I going to get a new iPhone? And two, I need a Tibetan Bible. And so he got to work early. He sat down in the park, and he said he was just sitting there, and this old Chinese lady walked up to him and handed him this big old Tibetan Bible, and said, "You should read this," and then got in a taxi and left. And he's like, he handed me the big Tibetan Bible, and I'm like, "That's awesome. Like, you're just thinking it, and God gave it to you. He prepared for this old Chinese lady, who knows how she got a Tibetan Bible, and to give it to you." And he's just struggling. He's like, "Yeah, well, it's weird, but, you know, she gave it to me. I don't know." So he's just trying to, like, make sense of all this. So I really have a sense that God is trying to get his attention. And I could tell you another 20 minutes, half hour of stories just in relating with him over these kind of questions. But it's been exciting to see that even though we're busy working, there's been good opportunities and lots of different ways to share the gospel with people. And so we're hoping as we go forward and move up into Yushu that we won't just always be busy running an ice cream shop, but that we'll have lots of interaction with local people and be able to bless the local community and share the gospel. So I just want to close with that and just bless you guys. We're happy to be here. And just may the Lord strengthen all of you today and this week to see him more clearly and to be more satisfied by Jesus. And then to go into your community, whether it's work or the home or your neighbors or wherever you're at, and just be a light and help other people, help bring them in to that worship and that glorifying of Jesus. So thanks.
Well, like I said in the beginning, we prayed about and really felt like this was the family we were supposed to take part in and be a part with in their missions. And I got to say, in hearing last service and this service, I'm even more sure and proud that we as a church are supporting the Musgrave family in Yushu. How about you guys? I'm going to have them come on up, actually the whole family, Bryce and Kelly and his tribe. They're going to take over Yushu just with these nine people. But I read from Isaiah in the beginning, Isaiah, and it said, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Folks, you're looking at some beautiful feet. Not just beautiful feet, but beautiful faces as well. And here's the thing. As Bryce was talking, both first and second service, I heard when he said that third point. You know, why should we do missions? Because you can't fail. And that's huge. You can't fail. And in talking with them, Karen and I had lunch with Bryce and Kelly this last week, asked them why missions, why China, why the Yushu people, and all this. And, you know, the answer is their heart. It's who they are. But, you know, he said it's about the size, Yushu is about the size of Boulder, Colorado, 120,000 people. Probably be easier to reach Yushu than Boulder, but that's another subject. I'm kidding. But here's the reality. To go into a city the size of Boulder, 120,000 people, give or take, who doesn't have a single church, no Jesus Christ, no gospel, you talk about a Mount Everest, that would be a Mount Everest-sized monumental task. And these folks, God has called to reach those people in that city, and I'm thankful that we can be a part of it. Here's what we want to do. We're going to pray for them right now. Corey's going to come up. Kathy's going to come up. Karen's going to come up. We want to lay hands on them and commission them, so to speak, because in the 2 years that they've been with us or that we have supported them, this is the first time they've been back, and so it's our privilege now to commission them. And also, I want to tell you, we want to support. They're trying to raise $10,000 to renovate and move up to Yushu and then renovate the apartment there and start the second ice creamery up there. And so what we want to do is we want to take part in that and help them raise that $10,000. And so we don't pass offering plates here. We don't have buckets or baskets or bags, the three Bs. We just have boxes. I guess that's a B. We have boxes in the back. And so I want to invite you to write a check if you want to Vista Church. In the memo line, put missions. Or on our giving kiosk, we have a button that says missions. And we want to be able to send them off back home up to China with some support from us as a church to get that goal accomplished so that Jesus Christ can be proclaimed with this people group. That's awesome. That's cool. Amen? After the service, after we're done praying for them, they have some of their incredible ice cream. It's not the yak milk ice cream. Yak is a little hard to find here. And so it is cow milk ice cream. You guys okay with cow milk ice cream? Yeah, it's still good. But anyway, they've got like seven or eight different flavors back there. Come back, sample those. And let's pray for them, shall we? Will you stand with me as we do this? If you want to reach out your hand, if you're that kind of Christian, reach out your hand and let's pray for them. Father God, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we are incredibly honored and blessed to be a part of the work that you're doing in this place of the world. And we agree with what Bryce had to say. You did tell us it's just a simple obedience to go and make disciples. We're thankful that in response to the beauty and the glory of Jesus Christ, we want to tell people about that because of what you've done for us. And Lord, we're thankful that you have told them and us that when we do what you've asked us to do, we cannot fail. And we know that you have a plan for them, and we pray that you would go before them, that you would be with this family, protect them, protect each one of these little ones. There's a lot of them. Protect each one of them. Guard them. Help them to be safe and healthy. Keep them from any kind of just things that would trip them up and derail them. And Lord, I pray that you would fill them with your Spirit and that you would give them favor with man as they have to open this business, provide the right employees. And Lord, we pray for the gospel. We pray for Jordan, that employee who Bryce talks with. We pray that you would open his eyes to your love and grace and he would accept you as his Lord and Savior, and many, 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 many more people would do the same as they're in this place sharing Jesus Christ. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray these things. And everybody said, amen. What is amen in?
It's probably in Chinese, amen.
Oh,
not as exciting as
like
you
that.
Hoped.
Amen.
But
all right. Thanks for coming today. We'll be back in the Word next week in terms of our study in the book of Luke. But go back, introduce yourself to him, get some ice cream. And we'll see you guys next Sunday. God bless.